Moving to the next presenter, which will be Rafael Bruxado. Rafael is an award-winning game designer, researcher, and pioneer in the field of classroom virtual reality. During his Fulbright exchange in the United States, he designed and executed the first ever demonstration of an authentic large-scale use case of consumer 6DOF VR technology in a classroom. His work has received awards from the National Science Foundation, Facebook's Oculus, and others, and it has been featured at the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts in Washington, D.C. for 2 years in a row at the request of the U.S. Department of Education. Rafael is joining us, but he has also pre-recorded a video that we will now show you.
Hi, my name is Rafael Bruxado, and welcome to my session. Thank you for having me. I apologize in advance if you hear any background noise. I'm recording this on my phone because it's the best hardware I have available to me at the moment. And I apologize for not being able to give this talk in real time, sort of in a transitory period at the moment, so I didn't really have good access to the internet, but hopefully this will suffice anyway. And, you know, if you have any questions at the end, feel free to email me and I'll get back to you, you know, usually within a day or so. So let's jump right into it. So, you know that problem where sometimes you're introduced to a topic that's so abstract, you know, or seemingly foreign or memorization intensive that you just can bring yourself to learn it. You may be able to memorize certain parts of it, but you never fully internalize its fundamentals. So a lot of people have that problem with math, for example. Math is the classic example because it's so hard to visualize. It relies on a lot of abstractions. And, you know, traditional schools haven't really solved that problem yet. You know, they've been trying their best to make it easier for students to grasp abstract concepts like in math and in other fields of study, but you know, just the medium in which these concepts are taught, you know, and the way they're delivered is not usually the best. And so what ends up happening is that when math is introduced in the classroom, it is often in an abstract manner that we just cannot associate with any personal memories or experiences that we've had in the past. And without those, without that emotional bridge, we fail to get excited about it and we lose interest in the subject matter. Like, sure, maybe we will memorize a couple of formulas for the exam, but we will erase that out of our memories as soon as we can. Now, I'm using math as the example because it's probably the most relatable one, but this could be applied to just about any other field of study that relies on a lot of abstractions. Now, for the past 3 years I've been living in the United States, I've been a huge advocate for a greater emphasis on student engagement over student learning outcomes. And this is because there's this huge emphasis on the traditional educational system, just the way the system has been built over time and the way that teachers are evaluated and so on. There's a huge emphasis on student learning outcomes. You know, obviously, if you remember school, you'll know that you've had exams where you measure your knowledge of certain topics, and so on and so forth. But you were never asked. School has never measured your passion for each topic. You know, we don't have tests that measure how passionate each student is about each topic. Like, for example, if you introduce chemistry, let's say, in a classroom, what parts of chemistry are each student most passionate about? Are certain students really passionate about organic chemistry? Are other students that are really passionate about other kinds of chemistry? Those are things we are not tracking, we're not measuring, and we're not putting enough emphasis on. And by we, I mean the traditional educational system. Now, obviously, teachers recognize that, you know, developing students' passions and student engagement is incredibly important. I mean, that's why we have things like field trips, for example. But the problem is that those are the exceptions rather than the norm. And you know, I couldn't really understand why. I've always wondered why don't we have more field trips. So while I was in the United States, I've interviewed hundreds of teachers and school administrators to try and understand why things like field trips occur so infrequently. And while I was doing that, one of the most unexpected insights I gained was that the reason students are so rarely offered interactive engagement activities like trips to science museums and so on was due to time and other logistical constraints rather than funding. You know, I thought that a lack of funding was the reason schools very rarely offer things like science museum trips and so on. But no, the real problem is really logistical. And so what a lot of them told me is that their bottleneck is this. Teachers are expected to cover all their curriculum topics in the very limited time they're afforded, right? And they're evaluated by that as well. So if students are gonna skip, let's say, history class to go on a whole day field trip to a science museum, well, then the science teacher is incurring a social cost because he or she is taking away some of the history teacher's available teaching time. If you gotta get 100 kids on a bus and then drive to a science museum that may be a few miles away or whatever, that's gonna take time, and when you're there, I mean, obviously you're gonna want to try to take the most advantage of it, and so you're probably gonna stay there for longer than a normal class period. And you know, if you do this often enough, then all the other teachers are not gonna be teaching. So you know, the science teacher is not incentivized to try and pursue as many field trip opportunities as possible because when they do, the history teacher might be upset because they're not teaching. And does they don't get enough time to cover all their curriculum topics, essentially. So this was very revealing to me, and then I started thinking, okay, well, so how could we make it so that students have access to these highly interactive and engaging experiences like science museums, for example, while not having to get on a bus and drive there and get parent permission and so on and so forth. Essentially, how do we make things like field trips more snackable, something that you can consume in 1 to 2 hours, maybe even 20 minutes, without interfering with the other class periods? You know, if we solve this, obviously students would benefit from it. This is something that students want. This is something that learning sciences as a field of study place a lot of value on. Like, we know that students gain a lot of value from you know, hands-on activities and just overall like interactive and engaging activities. You know, obviously looking at a whiteboard all day can be quite boring, basically. And you can imagine that students can get disenfranchised with the education system if that's what their classrooms amount to. And so we need to place greater emphasis on student engagement and how to engage students. And especially, I mean, think about it. If you're a student that's distracted by a difficult life at home, you know, maybe you have financial struggles, then you go to class and you're like, you know, you're hearing your teacher ramble about these math equations or whatever that are so foreign, and they don't, it's not clear how they relate to your everyday problems, and now they're gonna help you solve your everyday problems. Then it's easy to really zone out and not pay attention to what the teacher's talking about. And so we want to make it easier for students to develop a passion for certain topics. Passion is the precursor for a success in any field. So that's the problem I've been working on. Now, what you're looking at here on screen is Tablecraft. And Tablecraft is this sort of virtual reality science museum, say. And its goal is to first and foremost develop students' passions for STEM. STEM being you know, science, technology, engineering, and math. Even though we don't have all of those topics in the product yet, but over time we will add them. You know, the idea is that when the project's complete, you're gonna have access to a sandbox of scientific concepts. So you're going to be able to play with biology, you're going to be able to play with chemistry, you're going to be able to play with physics, and so on and so forth. And so in Tablecraft, we teleport students to this solarpunk sci-fi facility, kind of like the Iron Man lab, where we have access to all these wacky machines that let you do sci-fi stuff, really. So, for example, you have the crafting machine that allows you to deconstruct everyday objects and extract the elements out of them. And likewise, you can then put the elements together to build or to craft, really, any other everyday objects, right? And so, well, you're developing an intuition for what elements you interact with on a daily basis. And most importantly, you're internalizing that pretty much everything in the universe, I mean, literally everything in the universe, is made out of the elements, right? And I mean, obviously, you know, these may sound or seem obvious, but when chemistry is introduced in a classroom, it just doesn't stick the landing this way. And so what we do is we gamify it. So obviously, we make it silly and fun. We have all these aliens that come from outer space in Tablecraft, and they ask you for stuff, and they're like, hey, professor, you know, you play as a professor, sort of Iron Man kind of character. And they're like, hey, professor, I really need a diamond because I'm getting married and so on. And so then you got to craft a diamond. You know, you got to collect a lot of carbon and just put it together into a diamond. And so these are this is sort of how Tablecraft works. And we're not just doing this with the elements. There are several other fields that would benefit from gamification, you know, like spectroscopy, astronomy, biology, and many others. And those are all fields we're looking at and implementing in Tablecraft slowly, because it takes time, of course. But engaging gamification is extremely effective. We've ran studies in partnership with the University of Central Florida in classrooms, and we've had many students play Tablecraft, and it really sticks with them. They become very curious about the subject matter, and they don't want to stop playing. I mean, they come back in their lunchtime to play more, and they bug me every week, sending me messages on our Discord, which is our development forum, just asking me like, okay, when is it going to be available? You know, I already told my mom that to buy a virtual reality headset, and I want to play it. It's a really memorable experience to them, and so that's the whole goal here. We want to make students have positive associations with the subject matters, you know, like with chemistry and physics and astronomy and so on. We don't want them to, we don't want the first word that comes to their mind when they think of chemistry to be boring, you know, like, you know, that's not what we want. We want to make it so that when someone brings up chemistry, you remember the great time you had in Tablecraft, you know, putting together all that carbon to make a diamond, you know, something fun, something memorable, basically. And so that's what we're doing. Now let's talk about, you know, how does this actually solve that field trip conundrum I mentioned earlier, where students will get enough access to field trips because it takes a lot of time to take them to the museums, and, you know, it takes away some of the other teachers teaching time and so on and so forth. How does virtual reality actually solve that? Well, you know, up until very recently, it really didn't. You know, there were many problems with virtual reality costs. Up until very, very recently, virtual reality was rather expensive. It required an expensive computer, a powerful computer to run it. It was tethered. It took a lot of space because it was tethered. It required a computer, right? So you would end up having this setup where there would be one kid in VR in front of the classroom, and everyone else would just be watching it on a big screen, on a big monitor. And, you know, this came with a lot of other problems, like, for example, shell games. In their research found out that girls were less comfortable than boys being in front of a classroom wearing a goofy headset for everyone else to see. I mean, you look kind of silly when you're wearing a VR headset, you know, and you're tethered to a computer and you're in front of the whole classroom. And teenage girls were very conscious of this. And so luckily the hardware has advanced enough recently that headsets are standalone right now. There's no wires, you know, and their batteries last for 3 hours, which is more than enough for a class period. And you know, there's 6 degrees of freedom. The hardware is really good right now. You got to be using the Oculus Quest if you're implementing VR in a classroom today. But the software though still had to catch up, and so that's where my work comes in, and my team's work comes in. You know, we were funded by the National Science Foundation to try and tackle the software problems of classroom VR. And so what are some of the problems of classroom VR that could be solved with software? Well, isolation for one. You know, when you strap on a VR headset to your face, you're isolated from the real world. Your teacher and your peers are going to have a harder time talking to you because, you know, you have this thing in your face and you have, you know, maybe you're hearing the audio from the headset. And so it's harder to hear what people in the real world are telling you. And so there's a communication barrier right there that's not conducive to a classroom environment. Imagine if you had 30 kids wearing a VR headset in a classroom like everyone was predicting initially. That's just not feasible, because how is the teacher going to communicate with those kids? You know, like if they're all going to be immersed in a virtual world, and it's quite isolating, it's intimidating. And then, of course, I mean, not to mention that there's always going to be students that for whatever reason they can't or they don't want to use VR in the classroom. And so you got to accommodate those as well. And I mean, the teacher, you know, teachers are not going to want to put on a VR headset. A lot of them are not going to, you know, as I found out, they're not going to want to put on a VR headset and look goofy in front of the whole classroom. You know, that they're just not willing to do that. And so we need another interface, another way for them to interface with the students that are very excited about virtual reality, which, you know, it's most of them, from our experience. So Tablecraft overcame a lot of these problems using a peer-to-peer network that allows anyone with a smartphone or a tablet, a mobile device really, on the same Wi-Fi network to just join the virtual worlds of anyone in VR in Tablecraft. So for example, let's say you're a school that doesn't have the budget to buy, like, you know, 10 VR headsets. And by the way, Oculus Quest, they cost $400 each. So, you know, they're not super cheap. They're the price of a tablet. So, you know, they're affordable, but they're not like super affordable. But so let's say you can't afford to buy like 10 tablets or 10 VR headsets. Well, even if you buy just one, every student in the classroom is going to have a smartphone these days. Most students have access to smartphones or tablets. And even when they don't, I mean, schools have tablets and smartphones that students can use. And so anyone with a tablet or a smartphone can just join the virtual world of the kids in VR. And this goes for the teachers as well. You know, they can just use their smartphones now to join the virtual worlds of these kids in VR. And here's the thing, though. The kids who are in VR, they can see. They can physically see every person that's on a smartphone that joins their labs. So this mitigates, this does a lot to mitigate VR isolation, because now, you know, I put on a VR headset, I'm in my lab in Tablecraft, and then a few seconds later, any one of my friends can just join my lab on their smartphones, and I can see them, and I can wave at them, and they can, you know, wave at me. And we can communicate, and we can exchange ideas, and we can collaborate, which is another very important thing in education, you know, collaboration. Tablecraft is very collaborative. It encourages that. And another value that Tablecraft offers is student agency. You know, because it's designed as a sandbox, assuming the teacher allows it, students can pursue whatever endeavors they want in VR. They can spend most of their time just messing around with chemistry, or if that's not their passion, then maybe they can spend most of their time messing around with astronomy or biology or some whatever they want. Basically, they're free to pursue whatever they're most passionate about, and so that's the value of the sandbox approach, really. Now, of course, teachers can monitor what students are doing in VR, using their smartphones. Like I mentioned, they have access to a panel that shows you know, they can jump from lab to lab and see, okay, well, what is these students been interacting with? Have they how many elements have they discovered? You know, because when you're playing tablecrafts, you don't have access to all the elements, so you're sort of like discovering them as you go. And so the teacher can see, okay, how many elements have they discovered? How are they progressing? You know, have they discovered the radiation yet? What are they doing with radiation, and so on and so forth? You know, how many celestial objects have they analyzed and discovered? Stuff like that, basically. Another thing is that, you know, all of these hardware advancements also allowed us to rethink tablecraft and redesign it to become more accessible. You know, students today can be using tablecraft at their desks, and they can even be seated, and they can be using it very discreetly, which means they're no longer the center of attention. They're no longer on the spotlight in the classroom. And so in our studies, we've seen that there's no difference between girls and boys with regards to how much they're willing to be in VR. We use accessible design considerations. So, for example, you can play tablecraft while seated or standing, or you know, students in wheelchairs can play tablecraft. They don't have to move around. Students with very limited movement in their limbs could still use tablecraft. It's very accessible. This is dragging for way beyond the 15 minutes I was granted by Fulbright, so I'll just try to wrap it up really quickly by addressing the question of why virtual reality. And from the standpoint of logistical overhead, VR today is already far more convenient than the traditional trip to the science museum I talked about earlier. You know, getting in VR with hardware like the Oculus Quest is as easy as putting on a baseball cap, and you know, within seconds you can be in VR. And as other educational VR content creators inevitably follow Tablecraft's lead on how to design accessible and collaborative classroom VR, we're quickly going to see a growing catalog of amazing experiences unlike anything most students would ever have access to in real life. As schools start adopting virtual reality, every classroom is going to resemble the magic school bus, you know, permitting truly immersive virtual field trips into the depths of the human body as well as the vastness of outer space. Now, imagine being able to look up at the Great Wall of China in a realistic virtual environment that really feels like you're there, as the teacher is like lecturing about its history, you know, as opposed to just looking at a picture of it in a manual. It's obviously a lot more engaging, and it's also a lot more tangible. You can see exactly how tall it is compared to your height, and so on and so forth. And you know, these are things that you can only achieve in VR. You know, only in VR can you really play with the atoms or relive the Apollo 11 mission as if you had been the one to first step on the moon. You know, that's the magic of VR, and that's why I'm really passionate about it. There's a lot of potential for virtual reality in education and in many other fields of study as well, of course. But so if you're an educator, I would highly encourage you to look into virtual reality, see what it would take to integrate it into your classroom. And if you need any tips on like content or how you could go about doing it, feel free to reach out. Here's my email. And yeah, I think that wraps my presentation. Thank you very much for attending it, and see you next time.
Thank you so much, Rafael. Are you with us online at the moment? I think so.
I think he's online. Rafael? Rafael Burchard. Oh, yes.
Oh, hi. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. It's just to be able to talk to you in person. I don't know if you've been answering some of the questions over the chat. Thank
yes, I've been that. Trying my best.
And your presentation was really fascinating, the topic and the timing of it, and with all that is happening, and all of this virtual education, virtual we're starting to talk about virtual exchange programs, virtual mobility, if that is possible at all.
You know what's interesting? I have a funny story about that. So when we first pitched it to the National Science Foundation, they were saying, well, you know, education cannot just be virtual. You got to put this virtual reality in the classroom. And so we went through all this work to make it work in the classroom. And now they're saying, well, now we also want it to work at home.
Yeah. but it's fascinating. And the potential uses of this beyond STEM and even beyond secondary education into college education, etc. It would be fantastic to see how it develops to encompass all of these applications and types of levels of education that can be reached, right?
I
would have one question about your own experience in higher education in the US, graduate studies. How was that? You didn't mention that, but I know that you've had a fantastic experience at University of Central Florida, right?
Yeah, they were very supportive. I had really good mentors there. And from the beginning, I went there with this idea that I really wanted to be doing cutting edge work, and they really supported that. So I only have good things to say about the University of Central Florida.
How do you see yourself? We have Sophia asking, as a VR developer, how do you see your career in the next 5 to 10 years?
Well, honestly, I have no idea. I've worked in several different fields within the games industry in the past 10 years. I started in massive multiplayer online games, and then I've worked in the mobile games industry, and now I'm doing virtual reality because there's so much potential for it in education and in many other fields of study. But hopefully in 10 years from now, I'm still going to be exploring some exciting emergent technology, maybe not VR, maybe the next thing. I don't know.
Well, thank you so much, Rafael. This was really fascinating. And I hope we keep in touch when we finally can get back to the office. And I hope to receive your visit there. It's going to be very, very, very good for us to
thank you.
To reconnect after your experience in the US that you just finished. So thank you so much for your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you guys for having me. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you.